this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and I'm all the way here outside Dallas, Texas. Actually, this morning I was actually at the Coppell Farmer's Market, and I met the farmer here who actually watches me and knew who I was. So I'm like, hey, what are you doing later? Are you free? And he said, yes. And so I came out to his farm, and I'm making a video for you guys to show you guys actually how we grow microgreens in a shipping container. I said, man, if you had that like run on solar power, then that'd be like totally badass, right? But anyways, it's not on solar power yet. Maybe one day he will, and it wouldn't actually be too hard to convert it to run on solar. He just have to get some solar panels and enough batteries to keep the air conditioning running to keep his microgreens cool in the summer, and also a little bit warmer in the winter than it gets here in the Dallas area. Anyways, aside from growing microgreens, which is what I'm gonna show you guys, actually this farm, or the farmer, has been in business now for 40 years. It's totally amazing. He was probably one of the first organic sprout growers back in 1979 here in the Dallas area. Since new regulations came out with growing sprouts and having to have them, you know, chlorine washed and all this kind of stuff, he didn't want to do that anymore because he felt it compromised the organic standards. So now he's moved on to growing bigger and better, including microgreens that doesn't have the same strict, you know, chlorine water washing, you know, as the sprouts, as well as now he has a 9-acre farm here that for the most part he's basically using cover crops to create excess fertility. He does also do some composting. So besides the microgreens that he's growing, he actually has a full-on fruit tree orchard with peaches and plums and persimmons and jujubes and some figs and some pomegranates and all kinds of different fruit trees. Some he's been having some challenges with, especially due to a lot of the rain and some of the weird spring weather they sometimes get, where they get it nice and warm and then they'll get a frost, you know, even in March, you know, which is kind of weird to me. And then also in between the rows of the fruit trees, actually he's growing vegetables, which is actually, I don't see that too often on a farm, but I love that he's maximizing his space in that way. He also has a whole patch of, you know, blackberries, different varieties, so they're gonna fruit different times of the year. And he has muscadine grapes and so many other things. But really, I want to show you guys about the microgreens. But before we get there, I want to show you guys just a few things that he's growing on his farm that I really liked. The sun's going down, so I don't have a lot of time to make this video. So let's come on and check it out. All right, so now what you guys are looking at, we're here in the orchard, and you guys can see he's got basically some peach trees on both sides of me. And then down the middle, he has these cages that I don't know if you guys can see. Where are they? They're right here. You can barely see them in the picture. But basically, you just planted tomatoes and they're starting to sprout up. And he's got the drip irrigation running all the way down there as well. Now, I really like that he's like literally using the middle of the row so the peaches, they don't get too big. He keeps them trimmed back, plus they're a little bit younger, so that he could grow in the middle until these peaches reach a full size. Or maybe even if they can reach full size, he's going to prune them back to keep them small so he can continue to plant in the middle row. And besides maybe a middle row, he sometimes has additional rows on either side. So I've always thought, man, why do farms waste so much space and have a nice big walkway in the middle of the fruit tree orchard? Well, that's usually to get machinery down. So, you know, during the off season, he might grow some cover crops in here and then he'll till them under for fertility. And then, you know, in the growing season, he might grow something in there to maximize the use of his space. Although he still has plenty of acreage actually that he has not growing anything yet. So, the other thing also, the trees may shade out some of the crops in between, which can be a good or a bad thing, depending on what you're growing. So unless you're hurting for space, this wouldn't probably be my first choice. I'd probably use some virgin land where it has lots of open space, where nothing is growing yet to have the vegetable garden. Anyways, let's go ahead and continue down the property to the microgreens operation. So in this area of the farm, behind me, you guys can see basically has the like T-post with wire, and he has a drip, Netafim like irrigation installed for all the blackberries that he's growing. He found the blackberries of all the different berries grow the best here, and he has three rows of each different variety. He's even considering pulling out one of the varieties that's actually not performing well. And they're relatively low maintenance crops, although you have to cut out the canes, you know, after they're expired basically. But they just keep popping up and will keep growing. I like growing blackberries because they're black, they're anthocyanin rich, and also they tend to fetch a higher price, but they also, there's more labor involved to pick them. Most of his varieties are actually thorn because maybe they taste better, but also because he has so many varieties they're producing at different times of the year, so he'll have it for a longer season. Now, this farm is basically currently being farmed by one man, which is amazing to me, but it's basically, he's retired now, so this is his full-time kind of job hobby that he does to create a little bit of extra income. Plus he has a worker sometimes. So, I mean, to me, that's kind of just impressive that he's taking care of 9 acres by himself. One day I hope to have this much acre and have different blocks of fruit trees, different areas of blackberries and different kinds of berries and different vegetables and perennial vegetables myself. So I'm kind of admiring him for, he's kind of living the life that I want to live now, although I don't know that I'd do it right here in the middle of Texas, North Texas, where I could get into the single digits in the wintertime. To me, that's a little bit chilly. All right, so the only fruit tree that was existing on the property when he bought it many years ago, I forget exactly how long ago he bought this property, but he had one jujube tree planted right here. And over the years, basically, it sent up suckers, you know, fruits dropped, the seeds basically germinated, they popped up, and now he has basically a whole row of jujube. And talking to him, you know, I'm like, hey, what's the easiest fruit tree to grow here in the Dallas area? He said, jujube. He says, I don't do anything to it. Barely any bugs get it. I think he said the only thing that gets them is the grasshoppers. Then he says, if I get the grasshoppers, then I get the turkeys, because the turkeys will just free roam, eat all the grasshoppers. So, and it's basically not bothered by pests. It also will, you know, send up, you know, new trees on its own and literally create a nice, actually he's trimmed a nice, so he has like almost like a jujube wall, like it's espalier style, but he didn't have to even espalier because they're almost growing in a line. It's kind of interesting. And the jujube fruits, it's, you know, used in Chinese medicine. It's so delicious. It's one of my favorite fruits when they're perfectly dried. I haven't had too many fresh that I really particularly cared for, although when they're fresh, you can't harvest them and eat them like an apple. So if you live in the Dallas area, definitely want to get a jujube variety. This is kind of more wild style variety. He doesn't know exactly what variety it is, but they have plenty of name varieties that are actually plenty sweet. So one of the things that he did here that I really like a lot is he dug a few ponds basically on the property. And this is to catch water so that, you know, in the rainy season, it basically fills up, and in the dry season, then he can use a pump to pump the water to irrigate some of his crops. That being said, you know, most of his fruit trees, he actually doesn't irrigate. Because it does rain, you know, at least once a month or something, even throughout the year. If it doesn't get rain, then he'll go ahead and irrigate them. But yeah, I really like that. And then all the soil that he dug out, he created a berm. I don't know if you guys can see that right behind, but it's basically a little hill, so you guys can't see the front, like the main street. It also acts as, you know, a sound protection, also acts as a privacy protection, and also acts as a windbreaker, wind protection. From some of the plants that are, you know, planted right behind it. So really kind of like that feature of the land now, and this place would normally just be super flat. So yeah, put one of those in and dig a pond, catch your water to use when it's dry time. All right, so now we're inside one of the greenhouses here, and this is where he grows plants through the winter time. He doesn't like to heat his greenhouses because he doesn't feel there's a need to like use extra energy to keep things warm when he could plant things that'll stay alive, you know, with the temperature inside the greenhouse, which might be in the, you know, the 20s. So, you know, a lot of things like spinach and, you know, kale and onions will stay alive even in the 20 degrees, especially being under a nice enclosed greenhouse. And so he has, right now he has different flowering plants and leafy greens growing. He's got some tomatoes planted. But I want to show you guys where he starts his seeds, because this is actually really important for home gardeners as well as for farmers. You know, he doesn't just grow like out of the box, like just standard varieties, right? He really tries to seek out different and unique varieties of crops to grow so he can offer those to people. Because if every farmer at the farmer's market has the same ass beefsteak tomato, which I hate beefsteak tomatoes, so please don't grow those. He'll grow specialty tomatoes like he has some over here. And even these crops here, this crop that are coming up right here, which actually had very high germination, this is a whole flat of black goji berries. Yes, goji berries are usually like red, but these are black ones, so they're anthocyanin-rich. This is something actually I want to grow. I think he said he might even give me one of these little baby starts to take home. But the goji berry, easy plant to grow for me anyways, and they produce actually 2 to 3 times a year where in my climate. I'm not sure how they'll do here, but I did see he had a standard goji in the ground that was looking pretty good. But yeah, he looks through the seed catalogs and how he chooses things. He's like, oh, this one sounds good. I think I'll buy it and I'll plant it out and see how it does. He actually also likes to grow a lot of melons. So yeah, I would encourage you guys to check your seed catalogs and grow unique and different varieties, especially if you're trying to sell for market, because that's gonna, you know, give you the advantage of, you know, having something different than everybody else does, but also gives you a challenge on one level to sell things that people are not familiar with, right? That's where, you know, I really like to go to farmers markets and find unique and different things that, you know, people don't normally have, you know. That gets me excited, but probably most people just want to get their standard things. But I'm sure there's enough people that want to try just something different. So if you want to hedge your bets, grow a lot of the common stuff, but then also, you know, grow a good percentage, 30%, 40% of like different things, you know. I mean, I've visited farms, like there's a guy in Phoenix that just grows all different unique stuff, and he makes a really nice business out of it by actually bundling. So hey, check that link down below for that video. Anyways, enough about this. The sun's going down. Actually, I want to go ahead and show you guys his microgreens operation. That's super impressive me. He literally took shipping containers and modified them to grow microgreens. All right, so what you guys are looking at now is basically just a shipping container. This is a 40-foot shipping container that basically he bought many years ago and had installed, and actually he has three of them. In the height of his production back in the day of Cardo Sprouts Farm, he had all three of these guys running and would produce the sprouts and sell them. Nowadays, you know, he's maybe more semi-retired, but still trying to make a living off this. He just has one in full production and operation. Aside from the one shipping container, he also has some other basically delivery trucks that are basically just being used for the delivery truck part, not the truck itself. Because they're insulated, and he's using those to basically to keep his seeds as well as his harvest. So it's like a walk-in cooler. It's just the insulated portion of a truck. And actually the shipping container he bought as an insulated shipping container, you know, that formerly would keep things cold already. So, you know, it'd be a lot easier to do that than to buy one and have to like put foam and do all this stuff. So that's what he did, and actually I kind of like that. So anyways, let's head inside and show you guys how he's growing the microgreens inside a shipping container. All right, here it is inside. Check it out. You guys can see it's basically growing all up inside there. Let's go ahead and give the camera and do a close-up shot. So now I'm standing inside the shipping container, and I've seen those shipping container hydroponic farms with like zip towers and lights and all this kind of stuff. And I think those are cool. But I think microgreens are even cooler. And you know, he didn't even max this out. He could probably pack a lot more if he did maybe two deep instead of a single deep, because there's a lot of walking space, wasting a lot of space in my opinion. Anyways, let's go ahead and show you guys more about how the shipping container actually works, how he's got it set up, how you guys can do it yourself, and how he grows the microgreens in two different ways, like really old school style, you know, a lot different than other microgreens growers I visited. And actually that's something I like. Something that I don't like here is that there's so many damn mosquitoes, I want to get in the shipping container and shut the door to keep them out. All right, so now I'm inside the shipping container, as you guys can see, and he's done some good modifications to it, but not super much, you know. One of the cool things about this shipping container is it actually has like an aluminum floor that's kind of raised up, so it's easy to keep clean, unlike a non-insulated shipping container. That has basically a solid floor, so I think they know that it's going to get moisture, so they could, you know, keep that away if it is a refrigerated shipping container. It's also insulated. It has this nice walls or roof on it. Now he did add three, not just one, but three air conditioners to maintain the proper temperature. Basically, he has backup systems, and he has actually two on one end on that wall, and then he has one over here just to make sure that he can keep the temperature. The same year round, which is 72 degrees, and also the right humidity level. In addition, something that you're also going to notice that this microgreens farm does not have, that many farms may have, is he doesn't have a lot of fans blowing, which kind of is interesting to me. I kind of like generally think that airflow is pretty good on microgreens, but he doesn't need them because he grows the microgreens a little bit differently than some of the farms I've visited in the past, okay? He's installed a sink. Actually, he has a juicer there. He has like a spin dryer, and basically you can see he has one, two, three shelves that are growing. He could grow a fourth shelf down low, and then he could grow a fifth shelf up high, but he basically is just using it for storage since he doesn't need to produce that much right now. He does sell at farmers market, and for that he basically will get $16 a tray of the microgreens. And wow, this tray is actually quite heavy. And this is the sunflower greens. You'll get $16 a tray for that retail, and less if you are a restaurant and, you know, buying on a wholesale basis. And he's growing lots of different microgreens here. He has the sunflower greens, a really good staple, radishes over here, maybe another kind of radishes, and then pea greens. as well as broccoli. So actually, I want to take you guys on a journey of how he grows the microgreens. You know, once they're up and growing, he basically just does a full cycle. So this whole side, he basically just grows it for the next week. So some of these microgreens, like the sunflower greens, may take, you know, 10 days, 14 days. Some of them, like the radishes, may just take 7 days. And so that depends. But basically, he just grows this whole thing out at the same exact time, harvests them all, sells them all, and then he basically starts fresh and has new stuff growing for the next week. So every week, he's just filling this whole shipping container up with microgreens again. So growing microgreens is not rocket science, guys, right? You don't need a shipping container. You can do it in your bedroom, in a living room. I've made other videos where I show different microgreens farmers growing them in different ways, whether they're renting a greenhouse, whether they're doing it in a converted bedroom, or even their living room, or even a garage. Check the links down below for some microgreens growers that I've visited in the past. They're doing a little bit different here, right? Here they have like a nice, actually a soil mixture, which is actually quite heavy. I think they got some clay in there. Probably some maybe compost mixed with clay. I didn't actually verify what that is, but it's not just like a fluffy light mix or a soilless mix that many microgreens farm use, or it's not like a coconut coir mat. I mean, they have endless supply of this, like clay mixture outside in the soil here. They call it gumbo soil. So that's what he's using here because it's just inexpensive. In addition, he doesn't have any fancy trays. He's not using, like, you know, for the most part, he's not using like the black trays, although he does use some of them. But he uses these because he started back actually in the 1970s, 1979, he started this farm. And back in the day, Ann Wigmore was growing the microgreens. They called them sprouts back then, like the sunflower greens, the wheatgrass, which he still is growing the wheatgrass. And what they use is cafeteria trays. And so he has two cafeteria trays. He has a bottom tray, which is a big tray. And then he has a smaller tray, which is, sits on top of it. So basically he bottom waters all these, which is really smart. And hey, this is from Highlands Park Cafeteria. I guess he bought them from there. And these are cafeteria trays, and they are NSF certified, or some of them I saw were NSF certified because they're used in food service. And so this bottom tray, he basically just fills it up with water. And then he has these smaller trays sitting up on top. You guys notice in the bottom there, I don't want to tip this up too much to lose his sprouts. But he's drilled some holes. So, I mean, there's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's only 12 nice size holes. I don't know, what size are they? Quarter inch holes there on the bottom. So that basically the water soaks into the soil, and then the microgreens get watered. So it's like a super simple system to do. And I like the trays are, you know, kind of shallow. And I mean, he just did it himself, and all like NSF. Actually, his newer trays, here's some of them here. It's actually by Sterilite Carlisle, made in Mexico. NSF, it says right on there. Yeah, I'm not sure if it's actually the material, plastic, or maybe even fiberglass. It's quite interesting. So yeah, that's how he grows them. Yeah, that's just the soil and then the seeds. Oh, and then I want to show you guys this. So here's some of his radish seeds that he's growing. We'll just pull this whole thing out for you. What do you guys notice about this flat? Now, if you guys are pro microgreens grower, you're like, John, man, that flat looks weak, man. It's like, it's not densely seeded, man. He's wasting lots of space, right? This is like, kind of like, it's not even that full. And I was like, I looked at that, I'm like, man, that's not that full. He's like wasting a lot of space. But you know what? There's pros and cons to every growing style. You know, if I was growing microgreens, I would densely seed them. So I'd have a lot more microgreens for the same square area, right? Because he's not seeding them as densely, he's not gonna have as many microgreens, but also he's not gonna have the problems with the mold and airflow because they're spaced so far apart, there's good airflow between them. And because he has so much space and even racks and things that he's not using inside here, he could afford to do that. And so that's real, I'm like, okay, I get it. You know, you could afford to do that, not grow them too dense, just grow them, you know, more far apart. So you don't have the mold issues, you don't have all that. And I mean, it's a bit humid in here. For me, I know the air conditioner is kind of like, pull out some of the humidity, but maybe that might even be good. So that's really cool. So yeah, he's focusing on the certain kinds of microgreens that do really well. Now, aside from the kinds that I showed you, the peas, the radishes, and the sunflower greens, and the wheatgrass, he also is actually growing some broccoli sprouts, and he's doing that a little bit differently also than most growers I visit. So let me show you guys how he grows the broccoli. Alright, so this is where he's growing his broccoli sprouts. Then he tried broccoli in his standard soil method and it didn't exactly work too well. So he's like, how can I do this in some other method? Where do I have to keep buying this expensive soil mixture? Whether that's, you know, some kind of potting soil, whether that's some kind of coconut coir, or even more expensive, the coconut coir mats, you know? So basically, he just uses these standard growing trays, and actually these trays are open on the bottom, right? It's these guys right here. They're open on, how does he grow my greens in a tray like this? Hey, it looks like I'm in jail. Well, I haven't been in jail in a long time. Wait, have I ever? Yeah, so I did get arrested. Actually, when I graduated high school, my graduation night, I'll have to tell you guys that story one day. But anyways, so he just uses these standard trays, but what he does, he lines the trays on here, so now they have really good drainage on the bottom. And what he uses to line them is unique and different. And what he uses is right here. This is not even like really a gardening product, it's like probably recycled paper. This is from Ulan, and it's used normally probably for some kind of packing material. I don't know if you guys can see the texture on there, but this is kind of like a ruffled texture, so it's not just standard paper. So that's kind of cool. And he basically cuts this exactly in half, right? And I think this sheet is like maybe 24 by 20. So if he cuts this in half, it's exactly 10 inches wide. So it fits in, you know what, two of these. And then he basically just folds up the edges there and he'll basically just sprinkle on his soaked broccoli seeds and they'll start to germinate just on that, on the paper, which is cool. And you know, luckily he didn't harvest one yet, so this is one that looks like it when it's finished. And check it out, man, this is his broccoli growing literally on the paper. Literally the soil or the paper, when you're growing microgreens, for the most part, are just a place for the roots to set down, set in place, so that when he goes to cut these, they will cut easily, right? Let me see if I could pull these up. So if I pull them up, literally these are soilless grown, but they still have roots. When he harvests these, he doesn't pull them up like this. He'll actually take like an electric knife and it'll just touch the top a little bit with the electric knife and it'll saw them back and forth. So that's kind of like a good plan to harvest. I really like them a lot. Let me go ahead and try these microgreen sprouts, broccoli sprouts. Wow, they're quite good. I feel the bite. I want you guys, of all the different microgreens to grow, I want you guys to grow the broccoli sprouts as well as other cruciferous sprouts. They have sulforaphane in there, which is very powerful anti-cancer property in the microgreens. I want you to grow those. So yeah, this is definitely a really cool technique. He's made a lot of different modifications to inside the shipping container, and now I want to share with you guys some of them. Alright, so now I want to share with you guys some of the modifications he's made to the shipping container in case you guys want to convert your own shipping container or get some kind of build instructions or tips on how a pro does it, you know. So number one, he's using actually this PVC here, which is basically just 1-inch PVC. It's the, I don't know if it's thin wall or thick wall, but basically he's using 1-inch PVC, which normally you'd never want to build shelves out of 1-inch PVC because the problem is with all this weight, and let me tell you, his soil mixture, because it's the clay, it's so heavy. Oh my God, and he has like four trays on basically one span of, I don't know, it must be like maybe 5-6 feet just by looking at it. And so what he did was he found that the PVC, if he just had just the right size EMT, so that's electrical conduit, the 1-inch PVC fit this certain size, I don't know what size, EMT right in it. So he basically put the EMT through the PVC and basically made an inner pipe of EMT. So now this is really strong and none of these shelves are bowing. So I kind of like that he did that. I guess the other option would be to get thicker PVC, which maybe sometimes they use a 1.5-inch in this kind of construction. The other thing he did was basically bolted them to the top. So he has a connector here at the top and on the bottom where he runs the poles down maybe every 5 to 6 feet once again. And about, I think his spacing is maybe, I'm not measuring this, but it looks like to me about 14 inches. So every 14 inches he has another level. And he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 usable growing levels. At present time, he's actually only using two on this side or three on the other side of the shipping container. You know, if it was me and I was building this out, I might even expand this so I could basically put trays back to back, maybe like double stack them, but I might do them sideways on one side. And if I did them sideways, I could probably, you know, I could probably get two trays on both sides if I put them, you know, like go in this direction, like one, like, let's see if you guys can see that. Like one here and then one here. Oh, and then I'm gonna have a super narrow row, so I might just do two on one side and then one on the other side, so I'd have a nice bigger walkway. He does actually have a nice big rolling stainless steel cart that he comes down, he does his harvesting prep on and all that stuff, so I can see how that would be nice to have a little bit of space in here, but I don't wanna, like, you know, take some of the extra air space out because I'm actually a thin guy too, all right? And so let's see, the other thing he did was he put electrical in here. So if you guys see at the top here, he's run all his conduit and he has plugs and all this kind of stuff. Like actually at every down post, he has a plug that he then he'll run to a little power outlet strip that he can turn on and off individually. And so that's just a really no nonsense, pretty easy. And then the other thing he does, he's pumped in water in here from the outside. And he also has this water filter, if you guys can see that right here, but he has a water filter. So the cool thing about this farm is that he's not using city water, he's using well water that then he will filter to water all his sprouts. So they're actually already chlorine free. You know, I don't like to water my sprouts or microgreens with chlorinated water, even my vegetables in my vegetable garden. Also, the well water probably has more minerals than maybe most city tap waters, plus without the contaminants, because literally we are in the middle of the country here. Okay. The next thing I want to talk about are the lighting he uses. Oh my God. So here we have basically a standard, like, kind of shop light, and he must have at least four different kinds of different lights in here. When he started back in the day, he was using the like T12 fluorescent tubing, then he went to like some T8s, but nowadays he's basically converted his whole grow operation to LED lighting, and he keeps experimenting with different ones. When some of them go out, then he'll buy different ones. So actually over on this side, he has some ones from Home Depot that look pretty clean. Let me go ahead and show you guys those. So this is his, these are his lights from Home Depot that he liked. They basically just connect together and interlock. The challenge with this is that he's had some of these like with sections go out. And these guys, when he bought them, they're like $40 each, so they're kind of expensive. Since then, there's been better LED lighting come out. Like he has these ones on the bottom here. And so I think this is the style that he likes a lot more. He gets it from an LED lighting store here in Dallas, although you can probably order these online. And you know, the point is, he doesn't have any special like grow lights from the grow light supplier, right? He just found some LED lights that work well for him. You know, some of them he noticed like put off more heat than others, which could be a good or a bad thing. So obviously in the summertime, excess heat from some of the lights is a bad thing, although it may help dry out your soil you know, faster, which could be a good thing because if you're prone to getting mold. But in the wintertime, the extra heat generated from the LEDs are a good thing to keep things warm. Although the other thing is, you know, most of his lights that he likes a lot basically just produce light without any heat. So maybe some of the newer ones are getting more efficient and they're not generating excess heat. And what is excess heat? Excess heat is basically wasted wattage that's going into heat instead of into light. So maybe I would recommend actually trying to get LED fixtures that don't heat up. All right, so here's another tip for you guys. Oh, there's a mosquito. All right, so I just got a mosquito. You guys see him right there? Sorry, mosquito. but anyways, if you guys heard all this, like, zap, 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 right? He doesn't use any kind of like toxic chemicals inside his container, shipping container here, this controlled environment, because he has a door and he doesn't often leave it open. He comes in and closes it and works, and actually it's kind of nice in here being alone with all the baby plants. I kind of like it. but anyways, you guys see up here, this is insect control. So for flying insects, he basically has, you know, a black flag zapper, and the bugs will get attracted to the, you know, the light, the black light, go in there and they basically get zapped without the use of any kind of chemicals. So that's really cool. So yeah, I mean, I don't think I've seen too many farms with one of these, so I mean, it can't hurt to buy one of those. They're pretty inexpensive. And if it kills more bugs, so you have less bugs on your crops, all the better, especially when you don't have to spray and you could, you know, maintain, you know, a more natural growing environment. So although this grower has been growing sprouts now for 40 years, literally since 1979. You know, things always happen on the farm, and you know what? I want you guys to be all right with it, you know. You know, on rare occasion, you know, all his sunflower greens that were seeded, soaked and seeded and planted at the same time are all about this height right here, same as this height right here. But every once in a while, he'll get a tray which is the same seed, the same watering, the same soil that just does not grow as fast. And he doesn't understand why. And that's all right. Sometimes you don't need to understand everything. And I'm like, you know what? This is the tray that you want to save for yourself to eat. Why would I say that you want to eat the slow growing stuff instead of the faster growing stuff? Well, hey, the slower the sunflower greens grow, right? Say this tray can take 20 days to finish, but these trays you can cut in 10 or 15, 14. This took 5 days longer. That means the plant roots were in the soil for extra amounts of time to pull up more nutrition. They've also been growing longer. They've also been more exposed to the LED lighting to create more chlorophyll in the leaves. So those plants actually will be healthier and more nutritious, in my opinion, right? And so that's cool. So if you have something that takes a bit longer to grow, that's all right. You could try to like implement strategy to try to figure out why this is happening on one tray that are, everything is identical except this. I have no idea, but you know, just go with it, live with it, and hey, save that tray for yourself to eat. All right, the next tip that I want to give you guys that is one of the things that he does here is that he grows only certain varieties of microgreens, right? He could grow things like, you know, chard or beets or, you know, basil microgreens, but the problem with those guys is that they take extra long time. Plus, he knows that, you know, from experimentation that these specific varieties grow excellent in the way he is growing them. You know, I know with different growers of microgreens, sometimes if you're using the coconut coir mats, only certain microgreens like to grow in those mats and certain other ones won't, or won't grow too well. So I want you guys really to find, if you're using a certain system, grow the ones that are gonna grow good in that system. In general, radish microgreens will grow pretty much in any different way you want. They are really rambunctious seeds. The sunflower greens, generally I'd recommend growing them in a soil. They like to send down some roots. And the wheatgrass, right? He has wheatgrass down here. You guys can see that on the bottom there. It's a third row. But he's growing wheatgrass. And the wheatgrass also, I think, best is grown in soil. But, you know, you can also do it soilless. So actually, it'd be kind of fun to experiment with this wheatgrass in his, basically, his paper tray method. Because I've seen wheatgrass just grow without any soil. Although it's debatable if some of the nutrients are not going to be in the wheatgrass if it's not grown in soil, because even though the roots are quite young, I do believe in small amounts that some nutrients are being pulled up in the soil, even though most of the nutrition are stored in the seeds and the wheatgrass. The thing that I might recommend doing here is actually also watering with trace mineral formulation, such as Gropal, which doesn't add any significant amounts of sodium in here, but will add a whole spectrum of trace minerals to make the plants healthier, which means in the end, they're gonna store longer and stay fresher longer after he cuts them and before he brings them to market or after he sells them to the customers. And besides from storing longer, they're also gonna taste sweeter, they're gonna taste better. You know, I'm really into the trace minerals, and it's sad when most microgreens farmers don't add additional trace minerals unless you're like Hippocrates Health Institute that is tested and knows that trace minerals matter.
All right, so I've been in that shipping container so long, it's now dark outside. There's a little bit of light left, so I wanted to film a few more shots before I go. But here's one of the refrigerated, basically box trucks. It's insulated, and I guess it was formerly used for some other kind of farm. But inside here, he has basically a cool bot in here with an air conditioning unit. And if we open this up, I don't think there's any lighting in there. And whoa, man, it got a totally cold air in here. This is where he stores all his seeds. You know, you got to keep your seeds at proper temperature, otherwise you're going to lose germination fast. He does tend to buy in large quantities, whether it's seeds for his, you know, farm and his acreage, or it's seeds for his microgreens. And the thing I want to share with you guys inside here is where he gets his seeds from, because this is somebody I haven't heard of before. So on this label here, which we will tell you guys, he gets his seeds from International Specialty Supply, and they are at And their website is sproutnet.com if you want to learn more about the place where he gets his microgreen seeds. And the cool thing about how he grows his microgreens, if he notices he's not getting high germination like this bag of sunflower greens here, or sunflower seeds, the black oil sunflower seeds, are not germinating properly, that's all right. You know, he'll take those out and he'll just throw them out in the field, broadcast them, and then he'll basically grow sunflowers, which he will then sell for cut flowers, which in some ways will even make more money per seed than the microgreens that he's growing. All right, so I know it's getting dark for you guys out there, but I want to show you guys in the back of this box truck, which basically turned into cold storage for all his crops before he takes it to the farmer's market to keep his product fresh. Go ahead and open this up. And inside here, he's got lit up. So let's go inside his literally walk-in cooler inside the back of a truck. So I really like how he's literally using some of these old school trucks that have insulation already built in. And he basically just uses an air conditioner and a cool bot to basically turn this into a refrigerated, insulated storage area for his crops that he's gonna be taking to market after he harvests them. And he keeps them nice and cold. It's currently, the cool bot set to actually 45 degrees, which is a good temperature to store the sprouts and other food. So I mean, here's some sugar snap peas that he harvested from his field. And he has different microgreens. Here's some wheatgrass, you know, that he actually doesn't cut. He just sells on the soil in little blocks. And the other thing he does that I like is that he actually just will cut his microgreens and then he'll bag them up. And instead of putting them into bags and sealing the bags off, then he feels that the microgreens can't breathe. They don't last as long. He basically just leave the tops open on the bags. I think this is like this bag, I think, will sell for $4. It's like maybe around $1 an ounce, depending on what microgreen it is. And he'll basically just take it to market just like that. And so, yeah, he has different things in here. Here's some, he's growing the edible chrysanthemum, as well he has dandelions and other things inside here. So I think that's pretty much the end of this episode today. It's getting a bit chilly in here. Also, it's really dark outside, and I don't feel like getting bit by any more mosquitoes. That's pretty much it for this episode. There's so many other things I could have showed you. I got started filming late today. But really, the whole goal of this video is to show you guys that it is possible literally to grow microgreens anywhere. Whether you guys want to get a shipping container, drop it in the middle of an acreage where there is nothing there, get a couple old trucks that are refrigerated trucks. Even if the trucks no longer work, you could turn it into a refrigerated cooler box. It's probably cheaper to buy an old truck with an insulated box on it that doesn't work anymore than to build a new cooler from scratch even. That's another thing. So I really like how he's basically could literally move this farm anywhere. If he powered this by solar, I mean, he has a lot of LED lighting, maybe getting some energy efficient, air conditioning units, getting a good battery setup and solar panels. Literally, you guys could grow food anywhere in a system like this. So hopefully one day he'll convert it to even run on solar power. Hopefully I'll come back to this farm next time I'm in town, maybe during the fruiting season when all his fruits are in. If you guys enjoyed this episode, I'm gonna do more videos here at the farm. Hey, please sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also be sure to share this video with somebody else so that they can see how microgreens can be grown literally in a shipping container. Totally amazing. Make sure you click the videos, click the subscribe button right now so you don't miss out on my new upcoming videos that have come out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out so you guys don't miss any cool episodes, because I cover more kinds of farms and growing techniques and crazy methods than anybody else that I know on YouTube. And evidently you guys like it, because now I'm exceeded 600,000 subscribers and 80 million views, which to me is just insane, because I never thought I'd get this popular on YouTube. I just started doing this kind of for fun to show you guys how to grow your own food. So also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,200 episodes on this YouTube channel dedicated to teaching you guys and show you guys all the different ways to grow your own food at home. And make sure you click the links down below in the description for some other videos I have done on growing microgreens in various places. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.